Hello everyone and welcome back once again to Cauldrons of War. After last time, I felt a bit down because I was just not satisfied with the result that I got. So, taking the lessons that I learned last time, I decided to give things a retry. And that is exactly what you're seeing. So, I decided to not make this into a full LP again, because that would just take too long and that would be too boring. So I decided to play it without commentary, see where things would be going, and then afterwards I would record the audio later to talk about what I did doing this stuff at a increased speed. So that's basically what we are seeing right now. So I did play everything at double speed. So if you really want to see what I did specifically, you would have to put it at half speed, although then of course this audio is also recorded that way. So what did I do differently? So the first turn I only went for bombing the airfields to take down as many enemy planes as possible, and then I did not establish air superiority. Why is that? Well, you want to save your planes for the battles where you need air superiority later on in order to refit your units. So you want to save your air units as long as possible and not care about enemy air superiority in missions where it doesn't really matter. Like right at the start, you have four rail. So you don't really need airlift that much. Unless, of course, your panzers get stuck behind enemy lines, but that's beside the point. So that's kind of the thing that is a problem here, because you can't really use refit on your panzers by pulling them off of the line, then using refit and putting them back on the line, because moving back and forth costs fuel. And you don't want to spend, you know, all that time giving them one fuel and two ammo, and then you have to give them another fuel again. So that's not what you want. Now, another thing that I did differently in this playthrough is I was a lot more aggressive with my armies, and I really tried to push it. I had a much better feeling this time around when your units need refit and when they don't. So what I generally did was I really tried to push them to the max and then refit them in between missions. I no longer send out my panzers with just one fuel and one ammo. So I also made sure that nearly always I would be able to get my panzers back out with a reverse attack, I believe. Yeah. So that's something that I definitely did different. Basically in the north I did things pretty much the same as I did before, because that went well anyway, that strategy. So I didn't change anything here. This is all pretty much similar. But down in the lower areas, I did things quite a bit differently. So what happened here is that I was a lot faster with Army Group South as well, and I was able to get to Kiev so quickly that for a very long time I did not get the chance to go to Uman for whatever reason. But that basically meant that I was able to take take Kiev and Kharkov so quickly that didn't come up for a long time, actually, until after I took Odessa. So what happened is I never got the chance to go south because I was already beyond that. Like my panzers were already at beyond Kiev, at Kharkov, something like that, before maybe the prompt would come up, and it was already too late. So then I basically had to use the Romanians to take Odessa, and then that meant that after Odessa I got the ability to take the Dnieper, and that was a bit weird, but that's basically how things went. So in the center I really wanted to get past Smolensk Road as quickly as possible, and the reason for that is that at Minsk you have two railroad, at Smolensk only one, and then at Vyazma you have two again, and you really need at the very least two rail line in order to effectively reorganize and refit your units to attack all the massive amounts of enemy armies that come there. And you pretty much need to keep destroying those as they come along, because the moment that those bottle up, you are going to be in trouble, and they're going to delay you for too long of a time. So you need to keep smashing, keep smashing, keep smashing, especially in the center. I think that's very important. So that's what I tried to do there. Now, one other thing that I found to be interesting is that I also did something different in the north. So basically what I did is I tried to get as close to capturing or to linking up with the Finns as possible before taking Leningrad, pretty much. So I wanted to be very close to both taking Leningrad and connecting up with the Finns, because I knew that the moment that you take Leningrad, both the Finnish front and the German front get linked together, and the enemy armies as well. And that makes it very tough to break through. So that's not what you want. You want those to remain split up as well, because all the action points that you get for the Finnish troops disappear, because it basically becomes an army army group north front. And that's something that's pretty tricky with this game. You basically need to figure out where or when which front or which operation becomes part of which front. Because what, for example, happens here is I was able to break through at Kharkov, and then you get the Orel Tula offensive. And once you actually complete the Orel Tula offensive, you then go to encirclement from Moscow south. And the encirclement from Moscow south is actually an army group center operation. So all the units that you had in army group south then go into army group center, but you don't gain extra points for army group center. And that can be pretty troublesome, because you suddenly have to deal with two operations, both for army group center. So that's not really something that you actually want. You can see here that I'm basically just crashing my way through the Kiev armies now after dealing with that first operation there. So still no operation to go to Uman. But I wanted to finish off these guys so that I could just go and move on the next turn and then go through. So you can already see that the amount of enemy units is really starting to ball up here. And I wanted to get air superiority here at Smolensk exactly because I need that that airlift here, because I have very few rail capacity. With only one, airlift is going to be absolutely essential near Smolensk. Near Vyazma, you don't need it so much, but I think you really need it here in order to get that extra punch, get that extra fuel and ammunition, because airlift is kind of similar to refit in that regard. It gives you one fuel, one ammo. And if there is no rain yet, there is very little risk involved of losing airplanes. And that's really nice. Because that's also one of the big issues that you get. Like, once it starts raining, you can't really use airlift, because you'll lose too many planes very, very quickly. And that's definitely not something that you want. My initial tactic for the north is kind of similar. So the moment that you get to Tallinn, you kind of want to get to Tallinn quickly in order to prevent you from having to fight with enemy armies which are dug in with the Baltic fleet in reserve, which will make you take extra losses. It will be extra difficult. So I really opt to just advance on Tallinn, especially once there is mud and rain, because that really makes your unit less effective. And we know that the enemy doesn't get a whole lot of reinforcements there anyway. So this also gives me the opportunity to refit these guys before we actually go and charge in there, which is also something that I want. So, like I said, out here it's very problematic. We have only one rail. Still busy with refueling, but at the very least, with airlift that works well. Definitely opening up with the infantry. That's also something that I started doing, because what would often happen, especially at the start, is that your panzer units would then take out the weaker enemy units first, like a mechanized corps or whatever, or a fortified line, which is not what you want. Whereas if you attack with the infantry first, what would then happen is your infantry would then take the fortified lines, and then those are gone, and then by the time that your panzers get to attack, they're much more powerful, they can take out their actual armies, because those fortified lines are kind of in front, so you will kind of attack those before attacking their armies. Although that's definitely not the case here. You can once again see that the enemy units keep being stacked up, and yeah, that's a bit of a problem. So I decided to push through here, despite there still being a lot of enemy armies, not only because I did a Kessel, which meant that if I went to 100%, I would encircle those armies that were not in reserve. But I also need that double rail. So that's why I decided to push through there for those last few points, because I knew that that meant that I could just snag another three armies quickly, and I would be able to get the benefit of getting the extra rail line once again. Now you can see here, I went very, very quickly through Kharkov, and I'm already at the Korsula offensive. Still nothing with the Romanians, so I would guess that this is about the time where you potentially get to go south to Uman. But because I was so quickly, like I said, that just never came up. Which actually saved me a couple of action points for Army Group South, because they don't have to go down to the Romanians, which I think really does save you a few points, because what happened last time is, you know, you have to go south, you kind of have to go south to Uman, and then they reinforce the drive on Uman portion with those four corps. So basically, you always have to go east with Army Group Centered, despite me being at Vyazma already. If you choose directly south, you get less progress, so I decided to do this one. Because what this means is that I can quickly drive through with the 2nd Panzer Group that will encircle the enemy units at Gomel, if they have any. They don't necessarily need to have any, then you're actually done pretty quickly there. But I want to get back to Vyazma quickly, so I just want to get that part over with. And I found that if you take the directly south path, then that means that after going to Kiev, you actually get a Bryansk front, which means that your Army Group Center units are split up. And then the Bryansk front will afterwards go to Orel. So the units, the Army Group Center units that come, that goes to Kiev, if you choose directly south, will then go to Bryansk and then to Orel in the Orel Tula offensive, which is not what you want. So if you choose to go to the east, it will instead be a different operation. You'll already be at 33%, and after you're done with that, you're not going to go to Bryansk, but the units that are in that operation, they'll go back to the Vyazma front, which is a lot better, because it means you're dealing with only one operation and not two. So that's definitely what you want. You don't want to go all the way to Kiev. You want to go directly east. That is a very distinct and beneficial difference, despite both of them going south. The operation that you choose, if you select the option go to the east, is much better. Anyway, I was lucky enough that there were no enemy units at Gomel itself, so I quickly got the 2nd army linked up with 2nd Panzer Group, and I just want to get these guys speeding down the block so they can rejoin at Vyazma. Meanwhile, at Vyazma, whenever I can, I'm just going to refit. Unfortunately, it means my units have to stand there. I don't want to give any priority, because I want to have all my units get this same amount of points. Maybe you can really focus center, but I was a bit afraid that I might not have been able to get to Leningrad and link up with the Finns, and I did want to get all the objectives. So I decided to opt for not making Moscow a priority. Whether that's correct, yeah, it's debatable. I mean, you should be able to take Moscow, I think. At least that was my initial idea. I was already at Vyazma, so I was like, okay, I made distinctly much more progress. Much more of the enemy armies are defeated here, as you could have seen. They decided to reinforce with the 33rd Army anyway, so I actually, unfortunately, I had to beat them there. That was a bit sucky. Refueling, etc., takes a long, long time here, despite everything, which was a bit unfortunate. I decided that I was gonna get superiority here as well, because I really wanted to refuel them, because I felt that it was very hard to break through with only my regular armies, and I kind of wanted to have 4th Panzer to be refitted quickly, so I decided to opt to get air superiority in the north as well on the Luga offensive operation. That's a bit debatable, but I checked how many airplanes I had and I thought I would be okay, so that's fine. Now, in the north, the enemy just kind of killed themselves, and I was able to go through. That was very nice. That's very nice indeed. Like I said, this is all the same. First they send their militia, then they send their mechanized corps in the north. That's all well and fine. Now that we've got that air superiority, yeah, I was able to beat them with that anyway, but now at least I get to blitz and operate, or and progress quickly. So that saved me a bit of time, I think. So I think that's fine, especially because I don't need air superiority on the advance on Leningrad itself, or the encirclement of Leningrad. So I used a lot more shelling, especially down in the Romanian front there, because that way you're much more likely to destroy enemy units. Thought it was a lot better. What I also did is I tried to take it a bit slow with the overall tool offensive, because I didn't want these units to actually go all the way up to reach army group north. And that's what I was talking about. I don't want these units in the cursed tool offensive to actually go to the encirclement from Moscow from the south operation. Yeah, we actually cut the second Kapierkjager quickly for whatever reason, which was completely useless because I didn't need them anymore. But it's still nice to see that they can actually arrive on time, because historically they got too late, and that's why they said counterfactual as well. That's pretty cool. I actually kind of like that. Yeah, so Army Group North doing fine, and now with those Romanians, they kind of go to Army Group South. Because of the way that this works, if you cross the Dniester, you get them split up. So some Romanian units go to Odessa, and some Romanian units then go to Army Group South in the move to the Dnieper operation. Which is distinctly different from what happens if you go to if you get the Uman Pocket. Anyway, that means I got lucky, I think, because I got the 11th to Odessa, and you kind of need the 11th in order to do effective operations there. So I was really happy to get them there. It meant that I knew that Odessa was going to fall quickly, and that I would be able to advance much faster. I also decided to give priority to reaching the Dnieper, and not to the Kursk Tula offensive, because I didn't want those guys to move north yet anyway. That was outside of the question. I was lucky to just progress, and this is what I was talking about with Leningrad. I really did not air superiority there, but I did know that I want to have air superiority on the drive towards the sphere with only the 4th Panzer. I really needed that, so I was happy to use air superiority there now instead of using that at the start. Really kept attacking with my Army Group Center forces. And basically I did need to get my panzers out, so I did want to at least make sure that they were you know, not gonna get isolated. That was at least something that I really wanted to do. I was very close here to, like I said, reach beyond Tula, and this is the moment where I'm gonna start focusing on the southern front. I did say that the 11th is very good at taking out the enemy the enemy units, and that's exactly what happened. So I was really unfortunate to see that they actually got the polar rifles right before I entered Murmansk, but I was able to destroy them quickly, so that was pretty good. They turned out to be a bit of a pushover. So these guys usually go down with some air bombardments. I noticed that in my previous playthrough, that went very well. So I had to refuel these as well. I couldn't just go in and drive there. So I had to kind of reorganize the second. Took Odessa. Now these guys joined there. And like I said, I just had to focus on that. Just taking a quick peek whether they were doing some serious stuff. But they weren't really a threat. So you'll just see me progress a lot there from now on. Down here in the center, we are almost ready to resume operations. So I guess we did get it ready. Destroyed two armies there, so that's pretty neat. And they only have one of them left. So that really works out well, I think. There we go. They're wasting their armies there because they're never going to be able to beat the Finns. As usual. And there we go. So they send out a bunch of armies once again. Really, really slowing you down. That's really tough, actually. Kind of sucky, but oh well. Like I said, the Finnish forces doing pretty well. Recuperate the 18th. I do need to actually start working on taking Leningrad itself. Now, there's actually a way that you can get more points, and that is if you decide to not care about taking Leningrad. Which was actually pretty interesting, that you can technically get 15 points. I only thought about that actually just now while doing this or recording the audio after playing, is that if you decide to starve Leningrad, you can actually get one more point and not get 14, but 15 points if you do take all the other objectives. I forgot about that. So you can actually do even better than... Then getting the 14 points that you get if you get all the objectives, as they say, from the start, if you count them all up. And not that that's a foreshadowing or anything, but anyway, tanks go to the center. I'll just let these guys bottle up there. That's totally fine. Especially because it's not an important front for me now. So in order to get these points, you know, need to take Sevastopol, need to take Rostov before I want to commit the rest of Army Group South over to the center, because the center is already busy enough anyway. Enemy starts digging in, which starts to become a bit of a problem, even though we've now reached the road to Mozhaisk. These guys are starting to dig in, and that's pretty rough. Now, at this point, they have no more troops at Leningrad itself. So I know that I can just take the city. They actually do have one more army in reserve, which will join them, I believe. But generally, I can just go. So yeah, I can't refuel them. I have to do that by air now. I actually did not get air superiority there, but I do need to airlift. I actually got pretty lucky, I think, because those guys were dug in. It's good that the weather is not bad yet. I mean, there is mud and there's rain, but there's no snow yet. So the chance of me losing all my tanks in one assault, that's not actually happening just now. Though I do have to deal with two armies. Luckily, both of these armies did pretty poorly there. Now, I decided to get air superiority now. Like I said, I do have to refuel those guys by air, so having that air superiority will really help. It put up to 55th. I was a bit disappointed at that, actually. That I thought it was done there, but that was not the case. So, defense withdrawal to get them out instead of, you know, just leaving them isolated. That would be pretty bad. And just definitely not what you want here. Getting through Crimea, they don't seem to put up any forces there. The same kind of applies, I guess, generally with the Rostov front. Now, the thing that I found with Rostov is that you want to get there as fast as possible before they actually start reinforcing it. And for me, the ideal way to do that as well is to get to around, say, 70%. So that you actually have the option to then refit, and then you'll progress really quickly. You end up at the city, you attack the militia there, hopefully it gets destroyed, and you can quickly take it before they actually start reinforcing. Now, destroying all the enemy armies in the center makes me able to progress, even on the road to Mozhaisk. So that was quite nice as well. And in the south, I do want to get a few more troops, actually. Because the problem is that I'm not going to be able to take the city with the 4th Romanian army, very likely. So, I will have to send them basically on the next turn or whenever that's possible. I had a bit of a problem that I continuously could not send units towards Rostov, and I had no clue why that was. That was a bit weird. Anyway, using airlift now, because I can. Just wanted to take a look at what happened there. These guys should be fairly weak right now. They are probably exhausted. First is using my air forces, which in hindsight wasn't the smartest. Because, well, I was either Leningrad or going to the Finns. So I couldn't go to the Finns anymore. Of course, 3 further armies, just for giggles. Romanians can just only progress, and basically the same here. By this point, I decided to bomb them first and attack, wiped out the militia, meant that I will be able to take Rostov immediately on the next turn. So near Mozhaisk, I will have to deal with another few armies. And the problem is, of course, that 2nd Panzer actually joined up in the Kursk-Tula offensive. So they actually did not go back to Vyazma. That was actually a mistake from what I said earlier. Because, yeah, they do go back to Smolensk sometimes, but I don't remember the specific criteria. I've seen them go back to Smolensk, but they did go to Tula this time. Yeah, it's a bit weird. Well, there's a lot of things that's weird about this game, but yeah, that doesn't matter. Anyway, took Leningrad there, or at least destroyed that army. And over here, of course, we have a lot of units. And now I also linked up with the Finns. So just that final push, and that's why I wanted to really have those two be able to either do it in the same turn or very close to, because you really don't want to get into the same kind of trouble that I did last time. So quickly able to take Rostov, and with that now I can send other forces to the Don counteroffensive. I couldn't do that before for whatever reason, which was really weird, but I'm happy that I can send them now so they can dig in there. Once again, now I decided, because I've taken Rostov, there's nothing else I can do in the south, pretty much, except defend. So these units might just as well join Army Group North if I need them, which pretty much gives me... I did get nice rail capacity there, but these guys are not going to be the priority. Anyway, that's it for the first video. And I will wrap up this renewed campaign in the second video. From the second video, I will be playing normally, so it will not be pre-recorded with the audio later, but it will be, it's not never live because I always record beforehand. It's not like a stream or anything, but I will be talking while actually playing because this is new content for me as well, of course, because I didn't even make it past or close to Vyazma the first time, whereas I'm basically on the doorstep of Moscow this time. So, there will be one final episode, and that will be the next one in which we will try to take Moscow itself. I want to thank you for watching this one. Do hope you enjoyed the episode. And if you did, please leave a like, comment, or subscribe, or help me out on Patreon. The link will be in the description below. Take care. See you next time. Bye-bye.